Steve Collar. Let's get Steve on screen here.
Hey, David, how are you?
I'm good. And I wouldn't be surprised if you even have thoughts about some of the things we were just discussing. So we'll get to that. You're the CEO of SES, which is, I believe, the world's largest commercial satellite company. And you have 66 satellites up in the air. You can talk about that, the different kinds of satellites. You came from a group called O3B, the other 3 billion. So you came into SES, which acquired O3B, from a project specifically aimed to connect the disconnected of the world. So this conference has always had a deep DNA about digital connectivity. And you know, when we call, say, digitally united, we mean, you know, because so many people have been disconnected in so many ways, but the most essential one, as we were discussing regarding the SDGs, is getting everybody on the global network when 3 billion plus people are not. But you describe SES more in detail than I'm doing now. And anything else you want to say about yourself that I haven't mentioned?
Yeah, no. So look, SES was sort of the original space startup. Space is an incredibly exciting place to be right now. There's a lot of innovation going along, a lot of startups that are forming. But SES was sort of the original space startup 35 years ago. So we sort of founded the satellite industry in Europe. And we're based here in Luxembourg. And it came from an idea of basically radio broadcasting. So if you broadcast radio across Europe, you can reach a lot more people. And we took that idea 36,000 kilometers into space and thought about, okay, let's broadcast TV to the world. And that was a crazy idea 35 years ago. And it then became part of everyone's life. And we now broadcast to more than a billion people. So more than a billion people kind of rely on SES's video infrastructure. We actually carry more video than any other single company. But you're right, we also then saw the value that satellite could bring in terms of broadband. And that was sort of my time at O3B. At O3B, we were sort of the original innovators, and we now see companies like OneWeb and Starlink and others looking to use satellite connectivity to connect people. And our mission at O3B was pretty simple, and it was in our name, right? O3B, it was a reference to the other 3 billion who were not connected. And that's not to say that we felt like we would connect them. There's no company on the planet that's going to connect everybody. But I think the purpose of our name was to say it's important. It's really important that people are connected, and no more so, you know, then and now kind of thing. You said it well in the previous conversation that connectivity doesn't appear specifically in the Sustainable Development Goals. It should do, in my view. It's such an important tool. If you're not connected, you can't improve your situation. You can't get yourself educated. You can't get connected to, you know, you can't run a business. You can't improve your life wherever you are. And so the difference between sort of the haves that are connected and the have-nots that are not, or increasingly now it's underconnected. It's not necessarily that people are completely disconnected, but they're underconnected. And as a result, they're not able to achieve everything that they otherwise would. So yeah, it's an important part of our mission today.
Let me ask you something else. As the CEO of a big global corporation, do the SDGs play a role? Do they help you clarify your own thinking? Do you talk about them internally? Are they and also even in your interactions with other CEOs in your industry and out, do you agree with me that there is a momentum building in business of interest around these, partly because of Kate's work?
Yeah, absolutely. And so we do. We map specifically. We talk about our purpose being to do the extraordinary in space, to deliver amazing experiences everywhere on Earth. And that kind of speaks to one, extraordinary in space. It's hard to do what we do, right? It's not easy to deliver services, but we do it for a purpose, which is to deliver these extraordinary experiences, whether that be video or data. And then everywhere on Earth speaks to the importance of reach. And reach is sort of the superpower of the satellite industry. You can get to everyone. Sort of, you know, it's equally as easy to get to the edge for us as it is to the center. And we actually then map all of our ambitions against the Sustainable Development Goals. And we talk about you know, we're here to make a difference. And that's not just to make a difference. You know, that can mean locally in our communities, that can mean, you know, individually in terms of, you know, we have these kind of giving back days where people can go and do whatever kind of, you know, connects with their own personal values. But then just the work that we do in restoring communications after natural disasters, you know, deploying into refugee camps where people are by definition underconnected, it's all part of this idea of being on the planet to make a difference. And so, yeah, very, very closely tied to a number of the development goals.
Well, I want to get into some of the specifics of the satellite industry in a minute, but while we're on this, if one of the goals, I mean, I would say implicit in the sustainable development goals, even if it's not stated, maybe it's 9B or something.
Yeah, right.
Everyone has got to be connected or we're not going to get there by 2030. What do you, I mean, even if it's 2030, what do you think the chances are and what's the trajectory from your perspective and what you know about satellites and all global telecommunications that everyone will be connected? When can we reasonably expect that might happen?
Yeah, what the biggest challenge is connecting affordably, because actually it is possible certainly within the time frame of 2030 that everybody has the opportunity to be connected. One of the big challenges is, can you connect everyone affordably, and does everybody therefore become connected? And that's a problem that we still have to collectively solve, and it won't get solved by any one technology. It will only get solved by pretty close integration between businesses like ourselves, satellite businesses, you know, telcos around, you know, mobile operators, telecommunications companies, the cloud operators, the superscalers. All of these businesses need to sort of work together. And in some places, we're going to be the right solution. In other places, you know, a local telco is going to be the right answer. And so, but yeah, in order to connect all 7 billion people on the planet, you need to not only provide infrastructure that will enable those connections, but you need to make it affordable. You need to make it, you know, priced at a place where no one can afford not to be connected.
Interestingly, I want to just go straight to an audience question. Clayton Banks of Silicon Harlem, who's a good friend of Techonomies and has been at our programs many times, and is himself in the business of deploying networks in areas that aren't underserved. He's asking, why is it so expensive? Once the capital is spent, why is the cost so high?
Yeah, I mean, so first of all, obviously you're dealing with, you know, ARPUs, which are very low, right? So you're talking about, you know, the large populations that are not well connected, they're either underconnected or entirely disconnected, are in places where ARPUs are below $5. In many cases, they're below a dollar, right? And people are having to make choices between, you know, and it is very interesting. Once people, you know, have shelter, so they have a home or they have shelter, their next two priorities are actually food and connectivity. And those two things are not a million miles away from each other, which shows that when you look at people's priorities, connectivity is about as high as it can get. There's no problem with motivation. The problem is just in the balance of everything else that has to be afforded, connectivity is not cheap. It's not cheap to sort of deliver those connections, whether that be the infrastructure of mobile networks, the infrastructure of satellite networks, is not cheap. And so it needs governments, for example, to invest. It needs continual innovation on the technology. And we absolutely can get there, but it's not straightforward. It requires significant, you know, sort of commitment from everyone to connect, let's say, the bottom 2 billion, the most right, impoverished, the hardest to reach 2 billion at the bottom of the sort of the pyramid.
Thank you for that. It was a little bit of a side note, but very important to hear. But would you give us the architecture of the satellite industry? I know there's three basic types of satellites. Most people here probably don't really know that. Just quickly explain that.
Yeah, from a communication standpoint, I mean, the big the big focus at the moment is which orbit you're in, right? And so traditionally, satellites that deliver communication have been in geostationary orbit. And what that means is that as the Earth turns, your satellite dish remains pointed at the satellite. So the satellite orbit moves essentially at the same speed as Earth. And so you don't have to have anything too sophisticated. And if you're watching TV over satellite, you're watching it from a geostationary orbit. Now, geostationary is 36,000 kilometers away. So for video, wow, makes no difference. You wouldn't have any idea that the satellite is that far away. It certainly gives us a bit of a challenge because we have to, you know, we have to deal with these massive extremes of temperature and all sorts of complexity, but you wouldn't know about it. You would know about it if you're on a phone call, right? And if anyone who's been connected on a satellite phone from geostationary knows that there's a delay. And so you can't, there's an unnatural conversation. There's 600 milliseconds, which doesn't sound like a lot, but a sixth of a second for the signal to go up to the satellite and back down again. And obviously, if you've got a double link, that's causing a problem for your phone connection. But it also causes problems for data networks. If you're on a game and you're playing against someone and you have a highly latent connection, you're going to lose, right? If you're playing Call of Duty against somebody, doesn't matter how good you are, you're going to lose.
You don't want to play games on a satellite. That's one
thing. Well, on a geostationary satellite, that's absolutely true. And so the way you solve latency is you bring the satellites closer to Earth. You can't fix physics. You just have to reduce the distance between the satellites and the Earth. And that's what we did. The original innovation with O3b is that we brought the satellites down to 8,000 kilometers. So from 36,000 kilometers to 8,000 kilometers. And what that does is it cuts the latency by to a fifth of what it otherwise might be. And it makes it completely invisible. So if you and I were talking like this over the O3b network, over the MEO, medium Earth orbit network, it would be exactly like this. It's the equivalent latency to a terrestrial connection, and certainly a long haul terrestrial connection.
What are the typical devices that connect to that kind of satellite?
I mean, relatively standard modem. So you'll have our satellites, like most satellites, are essentially just mirrors in the sky. So that whatever you send up to them, you know, comes back down again. And so you basically connect to them with modems that are not unlike the modems you have in your house. They're a little bit more, they're a bit more expensive, and they're a bit more sophisticated. But basically, that's what it is. We're just
people who get satellite internet. Typically, that's the 8,000 kilometer version.
Well, no. So there's another orbit which is becoming more popular recently, which is low Earth orbit, and that's the orbit that the space station is in typically. That's, you know, you have a lot of satellites in low Earth orbit, and that's anywhere from sort of 500 kilometers to 1,000 kilometers. And so those are the three bands that you can be in: either low Earth orbit, medium Earth orbit, or geostationary, with geostationary being, you know, quite a lot further out. And so what we did was we said, okay, we want to get the balance right between reducing the latency, but not being so close to the Earth that you have to have hundreds or thousands of satellites, and then you drive the price of the network up. You have to invest something like $10 billion in order to have, you know, a properly populated broadband low Earth orbit network, whereas we can do it in medium Earth orbit for somewhere between $1 and $2 billion. And so you've got to get the balance right between the economics and sort of the performance.
All right. And I know that in because of your ability to manage latency, among other things, you're big partners with Microsoft and their Azure ecosystem for cloud stuff. So maybe quickly talk about the importance of cloud in your work, cloud computing. But then I really want to ask you about this surge of interest from billionaires, space enthusiasts, and how that changes the landscape in which you work.
Yeah, so cloud, I mean, so our approach to innovation is sort of sustainable innovation and making sure that we fit with other ecosystems. And cloud is the sort of the best example, but I would say telco and mobile is the same, that we want our satellite network ultimately to look like an extension of our customer's network. And if our customer is a mobile operator, is Orange in Africa, then our network looks an extension of theirs, and they can deploy services, network services, across our network as if it was their own. So we've adopted telco standards in the development of our own satellite network. And it's exactly the same with cloud. And as you say, we have a partnership with Microsoft. We're embedding, if you like, you know, Azure into our gateways. And so as our customers connect with our satellites, they're one hop away from, you know, the largest resource of cloud computing. And that a lot of our customers are also very interesting to the cloud companies. We serve aircraft. So if you're flying, you know, if you're flying above the US, for example, you're likely connected to the internet, you're likely connected to one of SES's satellites. And that means that you're, you know, one hop away from Azure. But that's really interesting to the airlines, because you've got this huge amount of data that's being created on, you know, generated on board the planes, and where you can dramatically improve the operations of an airline by, instead of leaving that that data in the plane and sort of landing and downloading it, if that data is available in real time, if it's going into the cloud, if there's a whole bunch of work being done on that data and being sent back to the airline to say, you know what, seat 14J needs fixing, or this engine, you know, is not behaving well in this area, or, you know, there's a huge amount of data that's being generated, and that data can be used to improve the efficiency of airlines. So our customers tend to be very, very interesting to the cloud companies. And, you know, similarly, we can make our operation, our network, much more efficient if we look like an extension of cloud.
Okay, before we get to the billionaires, Gary Bowles, who is a longtime activist and journalist and contributor to Techonomy. If you look at the Q&A, you can read this question yourself. It's the last one. I'll read it. My group is coordinating with a range of large NGOs who want to reinvent humanitarian aid using satellite-based internet service. What kind of scale of demand do these NGOs need to show how big that market can be in order to get satellite providers to provide better service at lower cost in less served areas? That's a very pragmatic and specific question.
It really is. And so we work with NGOs. We're a partner of the UN. We deploy services with the UN. And what we found, so there's a couple of big benefits with the O3B network. And we're just about to launch in a few months' time. We're going to launch our second generation network. We've taken all of the things that work incredibly well with O3B, and we've scaled them ridiculously. And we're now launching the next generation, which is called O3B Empower, which is the shirt I have on today. And that allows us to serve even more people and even more affordably. And so today we serve the peacekeepers, we serve a whole bunch of the UN agencies. I mentioned sort of connecting refugee camps. What you typically find is, and I think this speaks to the question, you typically find that the sort of the main activities of the camp demand connectivity, but those displaced populations never get access to it. It's just kept for the logistics and the running of the camps. And the average lifespan of somebody in a refugee camp, a displaced population in a refugee camp, is 20 years. So someone can spend 20 years in a refugee camp and never have access to connectivity, never have the tools that they need to improve themselves. And so that's something we're really focused on, is how can we not just serve the UN and not just serve the important work of the agencies, but also how do we empower the displaced populations to help themselves out of the situation they find themselves in? And that's the real value in connectivity, because it's a tool that everyone can use to make their lives better.
Well, I might even connect you and Gary, because I think you'd enjoy talking to him, and he would certainly, I'm sure, enjoy talking to you. We're pretty much out of time, but give a quick tip of the hat to the fact that the richest people on Earth seem to be obsessed with space and satellites. You are a very close partner with Elon Musk's SpaceX. Talk quickly about that and how it's changed the landscape in which you work.
Yeah, it's fundamentally changed the landscape. And I would say it's not just the billionaires, right? And I think it's a nice voiceover to talk about the billionaires, but actually what they're doing, the work they're doing, is really important. And so, you know, Elon talks about the need to make, you know, society multiplanetary, right? And not just establish a colony, but actually make Mars a sustaining population. You know, I think all of the people now coming into the satellite and space industry see two things. They see the tremendous sort of strategic importance of space, but also the opportunity it provides. There's almost no walk of life that isn't made better by satellites in space today, whether that be landing planes, safety at sea, mapping weather. You know, it's just about everything we do relies on our space infrastructure, and more that includes connectivity and communications as well. And so in the future, there will be kind of this integrated web of services that can get delivered from space, and ultimately not just for this planet, but for others. And I think what these people see is the tremendous and relatively unlimited potential of space. And I think that's I find that inspiring, and I think they do. And it's made this industry a very exciting place. And, you know, as I said, we were the original startup 35 years ago. The industry probably went through, I don't know, 25 years of much, much lower innovation because space is hard. And what's happened over the last 5 to 10 years is spectacular. We've got new launch companies, new constellations being formed, new startups exploring kind of the space station has been this amazing sort of resource for people to use to experiment. So yeah, the future is very bright, I would say, for the space industry. And I think what you see with Elon and with Jeff Bezos and a number of others is that they want to be a part of a big future. There's also a geeky aspect to space, right? There's a sort of a Star Wars, you know, there's definitely that, you know, that kind of Silicon Valley culture, but that's turned into serious businesses looking to do serious things.
Well, and I know you've helped SpaceX. You were the very first customer, I think, for them to launch a satellite. And also, I believe you were the first, you were on the, your satellite was launched the first time they landed a booster back on Earth.
Right? Yeah, we were the first commercial customer of SpaceX. We were also the first, we used the first flight proven booster, which now is becoming relatively common, but back then was certainly not. So yeah, I think that's one of the things that makes space more accessible, and that sort of continues this sort of innovation theme. It allows us to do the things that we're doing with O3b mPOWER, and couldn't be more excited about the launches we have coming up later this year.
Well, you're much more interesting to talk to than most CEOs. So I've gone a little bit over time, but thank you so much, Steve. I really think it's fascinating what you're doing, and we want to stay closely in touch. So thanks again.
Thank you, David. Really great to talk to you.